In this video, we're going to discuss the idea of concavity. Now, concavity deals with second derivatives of a function. So before we go there, let's just recap real briefly what we know about the first derivative of a function. Well, the main thing we know about derivatives is that it measures the rate of change of a function. So a function that has a positive derivative, like this first graph shows, you have a positive rate of change. You notice any little tangent line that you have to the curve, its slope would be positive if the derivative is positive. Or in the second picture, if the derivative was negative, you would have negative slopes, or you could say it has a negative rate of change. So positive slopes or positive derivatives indicate where a function's increasing or going up, and negative slopes indicate where the function's decreasing or going down. Now that'll help us with our definition of concavity in a minute. Now I'm going to kind of unfold the idea of concavity with an example. So here's two businesses, business A and business B, and both are good businesses. What I've modeled here is their profits from January through December. So you notice their profits are growing every month. So first thing we need to keep in mind is business A or B is neither one a bad business. They're both growing in their profits. So if you took the rate of change of their profits, their profit growth, it would be positive for business A and business B. So we could say F prime would be positive here because you see it has positive slope everywhere January through December, and here. F prime would be positive January through December. Now, even though neither one of these are bad businesses, which business would you rather own? Now, just basic mathematics would tend to indicate we would prefer to have business A. Now, what is it? Being that both of their slopes are positive, there's some subtle difference between A and B that probably would make you choose business A over business B for the future going forward. And if we put our thumb on it, I think this would be what would make us choose business A over B. If you actually picked numbers or found the numerical values for these slopes, not only are the slopes in business A positive, but they're getting more positive. You see the rate of change of the rate of change, in other words, the change in the slopes is becoming more positive as you move through December. And predictively, past December, you would anticipate them to get even better and higher profits. Where business B, on the other hand, yes, these slopes are all positive, but in every successive month, the profits aren't as large as they were the month before. So even though the slopes are positive, they're growing at a decreasing rate. Now, I'm not saying that the profits are decreasing, I'm saying that they're continuing to grow at a decreasing rate. So I know that's a little tough to visualize or comprehend. You really have to think about this. But what the subtle difference is in these similar graphs that both have positive slope is the issue of concavity. This is what concavity is discussing. See, with business A, the rate of change of the rate of change is increasing. These profits are growing, yes, but at an increasing rate. Where B, the profits are growing at a decreasing rate. So here's our definition of concavity. So a function can be concave up or it can be concave down depending on what's going on with the function. So we would say f of x is concave up at x equals c at a certain place. Now, how would we say the rate of change of the rate of change? Well, the rate of change, we know that's f prime. But if you say the rate of change of the rate of change, that's like taking another derivative. That's two derivatives because you're measuring the rate of change of the original derivative. So that's going to be concave up if f double prime is positive. And you can see that going on here. You have positive slope and more positive slope and a higher positive slope, etc. And now the second one is actually concave up as well. And this is important. Don't confuse being concave up with increasing. That's not the exact same. Because check this out. I know the second picture right here has negative slopes, but look at every successive point. Do you see how the slopes aren't as bad as they were in the previous point? That's also concave up. Slope of negative 5, then only negative 4, then only negative 2, etc., etc. These would be called concave up. Now, if you wanted one picture to typify being concave up, you can combine these two pictures together in a U-shaped graph. And that's kind of where we get the name concave up from. It's just, you see from this picture here, it kind of looks like concave up. Concave down, on the other hand, is where the second derivative is negative. So you might have positive slopes, but if they are positive, yes, but going at a decreasing rate, or not as positive as they were in the previous point, you would say that they're concave down. And if your slopes are already negative but are becoming more negative, it's also concave down, typified by this picture here. So you have concave up and concave down. All right. Now we'll go through in another video about how you actually take a function and figure out where it's concave up and concave down and those sorts of things. I want this video just to kind of be an explanation of the topic of concavity. Now, just to help you kind of wrap your brain a little better around this topic, I'm going to talk about a physics application of concavity. So here we've got a function. This is s of t. This is position, or the distance traveled, let's say, in our car at time t. So we get in our car, we buckle our seat belts. At time zero, we haven't gone anywhere. Then when you leave a parking lot, chances are you speed up. So the slope, the rise over run, would be miles per hour. So if I found the slope somewhere, the units would be miles per hour, rise over run. And you see, we start off with very low slopes, indicating a low velocity. So if s of t is distance traveled, then v of t, which is velocity, would be the derivative of s, right? It would be rise over run, miles per hour. That's velocity. Okay, now you see, we are, yes, we have a positive velocity, but during this first time interval, not only is our velocity positive, but it's becoming, we're moving faster as we go. So we are accelerating. So the acceleration function, we'll call it a of t, which is the derivative of velocity, that would be the second derivative of position. Now look in this first little interval here. You see the shape of it. Yes, the slopes are positive, but would you call that concave up, or would you call that concave down? We would say concave up. And that fits with this definition we gave back here. If the slopes are positive and increasing, we would say that it's concave up. And you even see in the diagram, the small portion of the picture that I highlighted looks like this. Now, in this picture, are we accelerating for forever and have this exponential growth for acceleration? No, there comes a time, and I'll change colors here, where we stop accelerating, and our velocity kind of flattens out a little bit. Our velocity slows down. So we still have positive velocity, but it slows down. Now, question, does this mean that we are going backwards or going in reverse? No, it doesn't. It means that you can have a positive velocity, an increasing function, but increasing not quite as fast as it was. You see, it's increasing at a decreasing rate. So here we would be decelerating here in orange right here. Okay, so that's the acceleration. So concave up and then concave down when we're slowing down. Now you notice this, there's a transition point right here in the middle. This point is pretty important. Matter of fact, when we actually get into doing examples where we find where functions are concave up or down, this point is going to be very, very important. Now, what is he? Is he a critical point? Those were really important for first derivatives. He's not a critical point because take a look. Right here in this yellow box, is the derivative zero there, or is it undefined? The answer is no, it's not. It's some random slope, but it's not a max or a min or anything like that. Well, we give this guy a name. Okay, the point C comma F of C is called a point of inflection. That's an important word, point of inflection, if the function changes concavity at that point. So right here in the yellow box, we would call this place, this point C comma F of C, we would call that a point of inflection. I'll abbreviate POI for short, because it changes from concave up to concave down right here. Okay, so we can do this graphically. We'll look in another video how to do this with actual functions without seeing the graph. But just as a brief introduction here, let's look at this picture. Now I'll just start drawing, and just think in your head where this is concave up and where it's concave down. All right, would you say that this starts concave up or down? Hopefully you said down, because it's concave down. These slopes are growing at a decreasing rate. Now, does it turn to be concave up immediately after the maximum? Would you be concave down until here? No, it actually extends past that. Even down to here is concave down. And then you hit a point where it stops decreasing at a decreasing rate and starts to turn back upwards again. So this will be concave down. But right about here, it looks like, yes, the slopes are still negative, but it starts to turn back upwards. So this here in light blue would be called concave up. They even fit the pictures that I drew earlier. And then here in this last interval, this seems like it's concave down again forever. So concave down, concave down, and the middle portion is concave up. Now, can you look at that picture and identify where these points of inflection are? Hopefully you can. It's where it changes concavity. So right here would be a point of inflection, and right here would be a point of inflection. Okay, now if you watch the next videos where we actually work through some examples on finding the intervals that are concave up or down for a function, or finding the points of inflection, you actually get a chance to work through some examples.